Dr. David Kimbrough and Dr. Randall Hughes work to unlock the secrets of the intertidal zone, where the land meets the sea.
This is what we're talking about. A productive coastal ecosystem is hit by drought and has its foundation species devoured by snails. This is not a video about the Apalachicola oyster crisis.
So much like in Apalachicola, the oyster fishery has been in decline. In the last decade to 20 years, we've been seeing significant declines in salt marshes.
Every few years, a La Niña cycle makes for drier conditions in the southeast. Hotter temperatures in recent La Niña years have intensified droughts and wreaked havoc in the grass and on the reef.
And so there were sort of these competing ideas about what was causing marsh die-off. Is it drought and salinity?
Like oysters, cordgrass doesn't like it too salty. And there was another factor.
When you have a patch of dead spartina, you find a lot of these. And Brian Silliman, who's at the University of Florida, did an experiment where he, you know, sort of tested both at the same time and found that the snails really focus on these vulnerable plants, especially when there has been some die-off. So when I came to Florida in 2008, I was aware of the work that had been done in salt marshes and the salt marsh die-off. And when I started sort of walking around in the marsh, I found that, lo and behold, we have a ton of the same marsh periwinkles that have been causing the die-off in other areas. And yet we didn't really see a lot of die-off. And so I got very interested in diversity, and particularly either the number of plant species in the marsh or the number of genetic individuals within the dominant species, Spartina.
Aside from the fact that we don't eat grass, marshes provide many of the same benefits as oyster reefs.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
How does a marsh's biodiversity safeguard these benefits?
In the Grass on the Reef is funded by the National Science Foundation.